to answer whether it is additive or not. And if you ask that new entropy for a given system with correlations like animals, like plants, like all kinds of things, whether that is extensive or not, you might be unable to answer that in 15 years. So the question here is much harder than here, because here you have to take into account the correlations between the elements of the system, and this might be a mess. So let me illustrate the difference between these two concepts through a few examples. I'm calling here W the total amount of microscopic possibilities of the system. If W increases exponentially with n, like coins, 2 to the power n, you should use Boltzmann entropy, because the logarithm of W, the logarithm of this, is proportional to n, which is okay for thermodynamics. But if you had a system like this, which increases not like an exponential of n, but like a power law of n, if you take the logarithm of this using Boltzmann entropy, this is going to be proportional to the logarithm of n. But you don't want logarithm of n, you want n. Because if n is very large, like the Avogadro number, logarithm of n and n are terribly different. So here you shouldn't use Boltzmann entropy, but you can use SQ, because if you take Q equal 1 minus 1 divided by rho, the same rho that you have there, this is proportional to n. So you are using a non-additive entropy to recover extensivity and to be okay with thermodynamics. Another example, if you have something like this, not this, not this, but this, SQ doesn't work for any value of Q. So you can use another entropy like that one. I will not enter into details. But for another non-additive entropy, then you can recover extensivity. Let me summarize this in this table. So here you have Boltzmann entropy, which is additive. Here you have SQ entropy, which is non-additive. Here you have S delta, which I didn't define, but it is non-additive also. Great. Now, you analyze a system like that one. You should use Boltzmann. Because when you use Boltzmann for such a system, it becomes extensive. And that's okay for thermodynamics. And you should not use SQ. Neither as delta. If you have this kind of system, you shouldn't use Boltzmann because it is non-extensive. And you can use SQ because it is extensive, and you should not use as delta. If you have this family, you shouldn't use Boltzmann, neither SQ, but you should use this as delta. Yes?
Why do we want extensivity?
So badly, yeah. I'm saying because you want to satisfy thermodynamics. If you tackle all these things within the Legendre transformation structure of thermodynamics, you will see that entropy, even in very general cases, is always extensive. The energy, the total energy of a system, can be extensive. It's the case of the air in this room. But it can be non-extensive. It's the case of, for example, galaxies, etc., where you have a strong effect of gravitation. Gravitation is a long-range interaction, and therefore it destroys extensivity of energy. But you don't want to destroy extensivity of entropy. To answer better, I would have to make a few equations, but that's basically the reason. Yes? Yes.
Actually, stochastic thermodynamics. But for what you're saying now,
Never mind things like Maxwell's relations, Maxwell's relations, Legendre transforms, things like that. Let's think of in terms of statistical physics. Do you have a particular, so in statistical physics, we don't have a particle bath, the number of particles is fixed. So a priori, that's not going to necessarily be relevant. Here's a question. When you say consistent with, do you have in mind a closed system undergoing Hamiltonian dynamics, leave those equations, there's no coupling to the outside? Or do you have in mind the case where there is an external system that exchanges energy?
Yeah.
And for example, as is well known, if that external system is finite, then Tsallis entropy actually arises from the assumption of uniform distribution over everything. Mm. Or do you have in mind a case where somehow the external system is infinite?
What I have in mind is any type of system, either closed or open, other inanimate matter or living matter, but for some reasons you suspect thermodynamics should still work okay with that. In thermodynamics, you have microcanonical ensemble, and canonical, you have grand canonical, it is closed, it is open, you have all kinds of situations like those that you were describing. But you would like all of those to fit okay with thermodynamics. But maybe we can discuss more later, because that's it's somehow the same question that you put. It's a big question.
Can I
yes.
Same question again?
Fine.
So, if I understand correctly, is it true that if you have a system of exchangeable particles, so like Bose-Einstein condensate, then it would be n to the 2 or n to the 3?
It is of this type.
It is of this type?
Yes.
N to the square? Because you have, maybe I'll ask.
No, Fermi-Dirac statistics and Bose-Einstein statistics belong to Boltzmann-Gibbs frame. So they are.
My question was,
there
what
are
happens
this.
When two systems interact, one of which is described by SQ and one described by the regular entropy?
Yeah, that's another question. That's like, this is a three-dimensional object, and maybe this glass is a two-dimensional object. What is the dimension of the set of the chair plus the glass? Is it two? Is it three? Is it what? No, this is two-dimensional, this is three-dimensional, but if they are at thermal equilibrium, they share not the dimension, this is two and this is three, they share the temperature. So it's a different business. Your question is analogous to what I just said. But let me go on. So, why we want? So, if you married to Boltzmann, you will be here until you die. If you married thermodynamics, you will be here until you die. So, this diagonal is more interesting than this column, for a variety of reasons, of which I mentioned the Legendre transformation structure. But among those reasons, you have also a historical one. These are the words of Albert Einstein, 49. He says that thermodynamics is the only physical theory that will never be overthrown. You can generalize mechanics, you can generalize Maxwell electromagnetism, you can generalize all kinds of things, but thermodynamics is a big stone you don't want to generalize unless you have a very serious reason for that. So, what we have done has a kind of analogy here. Here you have the composition of velocities of Galileo. So if the train is going 100 kilometers per hour and you're going at 10 kilometers per hour on the train, with respect to the land, you're going at 110 kilometers per hour. Why? Because it is additive. So this is Newtonian mechanics. But Einstein destroyed this additivity. It replaced it by that one, which is not additive. But why he did that? Isn't it beautiful like this? Yes, it is very beautiful. I can do 100 plus 10 by like that in my head. I cannot do this in my head. So this is very beautiful. Why he destroyed that? Because he had a superior goal. He wanted to unify mechanics and Maxwell electromagnetism. And to do this unification, he needed to satisfy Lorentz transformation, Lorentz invariance. And to do that, he had to destroy this. So he did that, and that's relativity. So here, additivity of entropy is very beautiful. Boltzmann entropy satisfies that. We destroy it. Why? Because we want to preserve extensivity. It's a superior goal. And to satisfy this superior goal, we might need entropies that are non-additive to be extensive. So here you have normal statistical mechanics, Boltzmann, Gibbs, Shannon, etc. And in this mechanics, you have two important fingerprints. The most important fingerprints are these two. The velocities of the molecules in this room is a Gaussian, a specific Gaussian, which is called Maxwellian, because it was found by Maxwell. And the second fingerprint is the famous Boltzmann factor, or Gibbs factor, or Boltzmann-Gibbs weight, the distribution of energies. Those are the two most important fingerprints of Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics. These two have mathematical counterparts. This business here, the counterpart, is the central limit theorem, whose attractor in the space of probabilities, or if you wish, the probability on which other sets of probabilities are converging, is a Gaussian. So this is the central limit theorem. And this has a mathematical counterpart, which is the exponential decay of some probability with the number of particles. And this is within the frame of the so-called large deviation theory. Perfect. Now we have generalized this because we generalize the entropy, and therefore we generalize the entire statistical mechanics. And this is what is sometimes called nonextensive statistical mechanics. Okay. So instead of Gaussian, you get Q-Gaussians, which is a generalization of the Gaussian that I will show in a few minutes. And instead of exponential distribution of energies, it's a Q-exponential distribution of energies. This Q-exponential is the function that I showed before, the inverse function of the Q-logarithm, which was the entropy. So this is in physics. What about mathematics? Well, we have this, but it would have been interesting to generalize the central limit theorem. So we dedicated many, many years to this. I started thinking about generalizing the central limit theorem in 2000, but we only succeeded 8 years later with two mathematicians from Albuquerque, Sabir Umarov and Stanley Steinberg, and also Murray Gell-Mann. This is the time we are working together. So we did some generalizations here, on which I will mention something. And I will show to you something related to this generalization, Q-generalization of the central limit theorem. But it would be interesting also to have something to say about the Q-generalization of the large deviation theory, this. But here I put question marks because this is not done. We would like to do it, but it is not still done. And this is why the three of us are working right this week here. So let me talk about the central limit theorem. First of all, this is the two theorems that we established with Stanley Steinberg and Murray Gell-Mann. And that one generalizes the central limit theorem. That one generalizes the Levi-Gnedienko limit theorem. And let me show a table for this. Here you have the normal theorems, q equal 1. So the systems are independent or almost independent in some sense. So if the variance is finite, the convergence goes on to a Gaussian. That's the central limit theorem. And this is why there are so many Gaussians in nature. The motion, the Brownian motion of the molecules. If somebody enters with a perfume, the aromatic molecules arrive through normal diffusion. The sugar goes into the coffee through normal diffusion, among other things. So plenty of central limit, plenty of Gaussians in nature because of the central limit theorem. This is that. When the variance diverges and some other mathematical delicacies, the attractor in the space of distribution is Levy distributions. So these two you will find in any reasonable book of theory of probabilities. What we did is these two. Here for finite variances, and you get Q Gaussians, and here for diverging variances, and you get Q alpha stable distributions. So here, because of theorems of this type, we only established a sufficient condition. We could not establish a necessary condition, but okay, it's already a theorem. Because of theorems like this, this is why there are many Q Gaussians in nature. So let me show one example coming from Tirnakli from Turkey. He published a couple of years ago. And he considered, with his co-author Borges from Brazil, he considered the famous standard map, which you have here. It's a two-dimensional system, X and P. It's conservative, area preserving. It's like a small Hamiltonian. And you have K, which is the degree of nonlinearity of this thing. So the molecules in this room are a nonlinear dynamical system, but we will never be able to see the phase space of this because it has 10 to the power 23 dimensions. But that one has only two dimensions, and we have computers, so we can see it, what happens. So this is what they did. So first of all, they choose value of k, k equal 0.2, 0.6, 2, 10, and they look at the evolution of orbits of in the space, in the phase space, which is x and p. And they have like this, when k is 0.6, they have a nice regular trajectories, but they start having a little bit of chaos here. And here, k equal 2, a lot of chaos, but still some regular trajectories. And k equal 10, big chaos everywhere. That was the intuition of Boltzmann. He was thinking about this when he invented the entropy and statistical mechanics and the molecular chaos hypothesis. He was thinking about this. But there is also this, this, and this. So let me compare these two. So what they did, Ugur and Borges, in the same phase space, X and P, they took an initial condition and they calculated the Lyapunov exponent, the sensitivity to the initial conditions. If the Lyapunov exponent is zero, they put black. Then they calculate another point. It is also zero, black, etc. K equals 0.2, everywhere it is black. Everywhere it has almost vanishing Lyapunov exponents. Here, there is a little bit of chaos. These Lyapunov exponents are positive. Here, a lot of positive Lyapunov exponent and still some region where the Lyapunov exponent is zero. And here, everywhere, positive Lyapunov exponent. So in fact, it can be shown that when you have a very chaotic system with positive Lyapunov exponent, you have ergodicity, and this is from where statistical mechanics, Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics, follows. Boltzmann did not call it Lyapunov exponent, because when he was inventing entropy and statistical mechanics, Lyapunov was a little child, so he had not yet invented the Lyapunov exponent, but the intuition was already there. So what they did in this case and in this extreme case, but also in the intermediate cases, they iterated with the map many times, and they made the sum of the successive iterations. Why the sum? Because they are inspired by the central limit theorem, in which you make sums. They did that, and they got, for k equal 10, strong chaos, they got a beautiful Gaussian. Log linear, this is a parabola, this is a Gaussian. And then they used the same program, everything the same, but instead of k equal 10, they put k equal 0, 2. And the system does not like Gaussians anymore, because in fact, it violates the conditions of the central limit theorem. So it doesn't like Gaussians. And what it likes, it seems to like q-Gaussians, which you have in black here, for q equal 1.935. We don't know the analytical value of q, but it is very close to 1.935, far away from q equal 1. And the distribution very different from this. So this is a complex system. This is not. Now, let us go back to the table.
How
yes?
How generic is this shape with respect to k? So if you put
yes.
So for k exactly equals 10, you get this the Gaussian case?
Yes.
And
for k equals 0.2. Here.
Is this exceptional or is it?
No. It is generic. If you take the best case is k equals zero, and then you have a Q Gaussian like that one. Of course, they don't have a Q Gaussian because a Q Gaussian is an analytical expression. They have numerics, but this is the kind of numerics they have that are well fitted by the analytical expression of Q Gaussians. They cannot go far away here and there because numeric breaks down. But here they have like 6-7 decades, so it's quite
but
strong.
For a certain orbit, it probably, for a certain k, it depends on which orbit you're in.
Yes. For example, here, if you take k equal 2, if you start from points here, you get Gaussians. If you start from points here, you get q Gaussians. And if you start from everywhere, you get a kind of linear combination of Gaussians and Q Gaussians. Did that, and they have shown, they have the figures, but I'm skipping all this. I'm only showing to you the extreme cases.
Can you help me? I'm having trouble understanding exactly what's being plotted on the next plot. So
here.
No, the next one. So you iterate this map many times.
Yes.
And you compute the sum of what exactly?
The sum of the variable x. x1 plus x2 plus x3 n times.
It's on a circle or something.
Yes. Okay?
And so if it's many of these going to periodic orbits.
Yes.
And so then you're just like summing a repeating sequence.
Yes. Excepting that they are not exactly periodic. It's interesting that you put that question. Because you see here, that gives you the impression, that one, that it is periodic. It's not. This is not like the moon turning around the earth. You know how this is? This is a great mystery. It is here, and it jumps there, and it jumps there, tuck, 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 tuck. And when it comes back, it does not come back to the point where you started, but nearby. And tuck, 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 nearby, nearby. You do it a lot of time, and you have the impression that it is like the moon around the earth. It's not. It's a mysterious orbit, which never closes into itself. It's irrational numbers inside.
Is there a continuous time version?
Sorry?
Is there a continuous time version of this?
Perhaps, but they are analyzing the standard map. The standard map started from a continuous set of equations that were approximated by discrete variables, and this is what they are discussing. Yes. Well, I'm not very familiar. These are physical systems in which time is continuous. starting from this, they arrive to this. Yes. Yes. Yeah, probably. Yes. Yes. Yeah, yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, not in two dimensions, yeah.
But this is quite generic for any non-integrable Hamiltonian dynamics.
Yeah, it is. It is, it is, yeah. The standard map is the most famous conservative low-dimensional map, like the logistic map is the most famous dissipative low-dimensional map. Those are the big maps when you start studying nonlinear dynamics. Usually you start with those. So they discovered something very interesting in a map which is known since half a century. Okay, so going back here, let me talk a little bit about this, which is what we are doing this week together. So an attempt to generalize the large deviation theory, which is the mathematical counterpart of the most ubiquitous distribution of energies in physics. So here, yes.
So, right, you want to generalize it, and you said that here it's a IID, and here you have correlations between the points.
Yeah. Strong correlations, yeah. Not a little correlations.
Do you think that in the generalization, any correlations between points will go into that box, or is it like just very standardized correlations that will go in there? And if you have higher order correlations and so on, it will not fit in there. It will be some other central.
Yeah. Let me answer to your question through an example. You probably are aware of the Ising model, which is interaction between spins. What kind of interaction? First neighbor interaction. First neighbor interactions belongs to this, first neighbor. Then you say, okay, I want to study first and second neighbor's interaction. Still belongs to this. First and second and third neighbor, it still belongs to this. Now I want to do like gravitation, first and second and third and fourth, all the way long interactions, slowly decaying with space. This is gravitation. Then it does not belong here. It belongs there. So that's the kind of... Yes, yes. In the classical case, the decay of interactions, one divided by distance, power alpha has to be above d, the dimension of the system. Alpha divided by d must be above 1. If it is so, you are here. If you are below 1, like gravitation, you are here.
So I think that this does not answer Michael's question. I think, so you replace in the central limit theorem, you replace independence, which you have in the classical setting, by Q independence, which is a particular kind of correlation structure.
Yes.
It corresponds to a particular kind of correlation structure.
Yeah. Yes.
For that case, there's a theorem saying that this is what you get. But and you observe in some examples, you observe also this convergence to a Q exponential. But there's no general theorem saying specifying the kinds of correlations that would give you.
Yeah.
We know it's not just the Q independence; it's more than that.
More than that.
But I think there's no conclusive.
No, not yet. But we know it's Q independence is a sufficient condition, but not necessary. This we know through examples. Okay, so let me talk about this a little bit. So we started trying to generalize a large deviation theory for a strongly correlated system with a Spanish lady, Guiomar Ruiz. And in these papers, we analyzed a purely probabilistic model. And we started with n coins, n independent coins. So So when you discuss this, you easily can check the probability of, as a function of n, and I will say what probability, decays exponentially with n. So this is logarithm versus linear, and you see straight lines. So the probability decays exponentially with n. This probability decays exponentially with n here. What probability is that? This is the probability having, say, up to 20% of heads for 100 coins, 1,000 coins, 10,000 coins, 10 millions of coins. So when n increases, what is the probability of having up to 20% heads? It goes to zero, because the distribution becomes very peaked around 50%. So you are in 20%, you are out of the peak, so it goes to zero. How it goes to zero? Very quickly, exponentially quick. But this expression has something very, very interesting. This number here. This number here, which of course depends on x, is a relative entropy per particle. It's an intensive quantity. And therefore, this times this is a total entropy, and it is extensive. You see, it is proportional to n. So here is another answer to your question. Why do you want so much to have extensivity? Well, because we have this theorem, and here you have the total entropy, which is proportional to n.
So you said
it's
a relative entropy?
Per particle. Well, it's the expression R1 of x is logarithm of 2 plus x logarithm of x plus 1 minus x logarithm of 1 minus x. And this is relative Shannon entropy for a coin, for one coin. So those slopes are for different values of x. So we check this. Oh, it is there. You have it here. Scott, it's coming. Got, I don't know. No, I think it's something here. Unplug and plug again.
But it says network link is down.
No, but I think this is because it doesn't.
Maybe.
Maybe can you turn off and on the? No.
So I take it out. Maybe you turn it on.
Maybe we turn this. Okay. Maybe plug it in. Just a few seconds.
Mm-hmm.
ask a question?
Yes, but we should make this work. Otherwise, it's impossible to. Maybe you can call Nathan.
Well, there are tech guys on campus right now.
Oh, the two of them. No, here? No, it's here.
Eh?
Well, if you wish.
Sorry. Or can we connect to that? We can
looks like his computer is still coming in on the live stream. Yeah, your desktop is on the live stream.
Can we get that?
If you do your projection.
Can you maybe
okay.
You've jiggled all of these.
Just plug it in there.
Right, like this is... Well, I mean, you might just try to plug it back in. It should be working through that because we're seeing it.
Okay.
Through this,
yes.
No, I think what it is the connection from this to the projector.
So now we see it there?
Because it was on the stream.
Yeah.
Your desktop was on the stream. It just wasn't coming in through the projector. And I don't know...
So you might want to restart the router or whatever is down there instead of
to restart what?
There's some network machine down here that you could might want to restart.
Okay.
Well, as I say, you go to shift. Yeah, ride it on
wherever the power button is.
Or else can I come up to you? Is it a total failure at this point?
It says the network link is down. So I mean, are we trying to restart the network router?
Did we lose our whole
connection? No. Everything's fine. It's just that projector seems to be disconnected from the, which is.
I'm trying to find the gateway.
Oh,
wow. Okay.
Therefore, this guy, right? But it's not. It's the point.
Yeah, but.
Okay. It's good. Yeah, it's good.
It's not good.
Not very good.
Better than nothing.
Better than nothing. Oh, view.
It's like the chaotic regime.
Full screen. Let us see. It's kind of crazy, but.
Yeah. But, yeah, I think it's
okay. So, with all this, I think we lost.
We still have an audience online, for what it's worth. And it's being recorded. Maybe
yeah. So, we were here. This is independent coins. You have those exponential lines. Then we checked a purely probabilistic model that contains the independent lines as a particular case. And we found the Q exponentials here. So
are the coins here correlated?
It's a complicated correlation, but it's a strong correlation between the entire set of coins. I would have to explain it very lengthily. It's a paper done by people, half physicists, half mathematicians, and we use that particular model to check whether the large deviation theory generalizes into Q exponentials, and it does.
But if I came up with an arbitrary, some other correlation scheme, would I also be able to get a Q?
In many of them, we believe you will have a Q exponential or close to it, but other classes would be outside.
So, I mean, one model where people do correlated coins is where you choose the coin and then you flip it an infinite number of times.
Yeah.
And when you do that, I think then you get Gaussian.
Yeah. So it's more than that. It's more than that, yes. So here you have capital Q Gaussians, for example, Q equals 3/2. And here you have small Q exponentials. And here you have the analytical expression between small Q and capital Q. And you see that when you take Gaussians, capital Q is equal to 1. So this disappears. And small Q equals to 1. So you get exponentials. And that's the normal large deviation theory. So you have the large deviation theory as a particular case of this. Okay. Yes.
And it's not, you can't write that large deviation with the regular exponential just by changing the rate function.
No, not at all. Because it's not exponential. It's Q exponential. It's a power law instead of being an exponential law. It changes drastically. Like a power law. Yeah, exactly. This is what we are studying here, is a kind of power law, large deviation theory. Yes. So let me skip this. And here we arrive to the systems that we have been studying, the three of us. So there you have four dynamical systems, not purely probabilistic, but also involving dynamics. In all of those, the dynamics are nonlinear, but with zero Lyapunov exponent. So they are weakly chaotic instead of being strongly chaotic. When they are strongly chaotic, you have the normal standard limit theorems. So the system that we have studied is the standard map for k equals 0 and compared with k equals 10. We have studied the coherent noise model for biological extinctions and earthquakes. We have studied Paul and Tatiana Ehrenfest dog flea model of 1907. And finally, we have studied avalanches related to random walks. I don't have time, really, to present the details about all this, but let me just tell you that they show here straight lines. And this is the case k equal 10. So this is the normal large deviation theory. You see logarithm versus n is a straight line. But we have studied also k equals 0, where you have weak chaos, zero Lyapunov exponents. And there, you again have straight lines. And these straight lines are very important because you can see it here. This probability, instead of going to zero exponentially quick, it goes like a Q exponential quick, which is basically a power law. But the interesting point here is that this number appears to be something like a generalized entropy per particle multiplied by n is the total entropy, and it is still extensive. It is here proportional to n, not to n power 1.3, n. So the total entropy is extensive. And this is very important because we always want to be consistent with thermodynamics. Well, because of the time, I will have to skip all these details. We are trying to understand this and perhaps formulate one or two theorems, generalizing the usual ones that are in the literature. And here, as you see, there are different values of Q. Here one number, here another one. For the same system, you have different values of Q depending on what property you are analyzing. But for Q equal 1, they coincide. If capital Q equals 1, small q also equals 1. So when you are in Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics, all important quantities are exponential. When you go to complex systems, this exponential behavior breaks down into power laws, a lot of power laws that are related among them, but they are different. So you have various values of Q. Like here, you have two values of Q. Two. No, here is one. So this kind of situation leads us to discuss sets of indices Q, related for the same system to different properties, to different classes of properties. And this started with an Italian student asking a question about that. So I conjectured in 2004 that there might be something like three values of Q, Q sensitivity, Q relaxation, Q stationary state. This conjecture was 1 year after verified at NASA. And they did find the values of Q, minus 0.6, 3.8, 1.75. So the values of Q, the q-triplet, exists, and they found it in the solar wind through the data of Voyager 1 that was at the end of the planetary system, after Pluto. And it was sending the signals, and those signals were analyzed by a NASA, and they got this that you see here.
So what do you mean by they were verified, this triplet was verified?
Because they could calculate Q sensitivity, they could calculate Q relaxation, and they could calculate Q stationary state, and they found three different values. There are details of how they calculate that, and that was the idea of the Q triplet. There were three different values of Q. When you go to Boltzmann statistics, these three values collapse onto Q equal 1. And this is why Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics is relatively simple, because you have only one value of Q, and it is equal to 1. But when you go to Q statistics, it becomes much more complicated.
And so the Q that you were calculating on the standard band,
is one of those.
One of those,
yes, yes. Well, it's related to the stationary state, yeah. That kind of one.
Right.
Yeah.
Because you take a long sum, so it's really more the stationary state.
Yes, yes. Okay, so they did find that. But then, at this point, I made a seminar here showing, many years ago, showing that the Q triplet does exist, and Murray Gell-Mann became very interested to understand what are these values. So where do they come from? Are all independent? And the idea is that they are not independent. They are related through connections. And in this paper with Murray Gell-Mann and a Japanese student that was here at the time, we suggested that the transformations that were involved in this were this called additive duality and that one called multiplicative duality. And you see here, Q equal 1 is a fixed point. If you take 1, it transforms into 1. And here also Q equal 1 is a fixed point. And also, If you take twice this, it gets you identity. So it's dual. If you do it again, you go back to the beginning. And here, if you do it again, you go back to the beginning. One divided by Q is? Four, where are you? No. This, with these transformations, we could obtain these connections. And these connections involved three values of Q that you see here. These are transformations within which you can find the connections between these. Okay, so we found this. We published that in that paper, 2005. And it was necessary to explain tables with a lot of q-triplets and things complicated like the ones that we are studying right now. There are several values of q, and how are they connected? So I suggested a couple of years ago that we could generalize the expression of 2 minus q and 1 divided by q, generalize that, unify this, by using this expression. And in this transformation here, if you take q equal 1, you have a plus 2 minus a, 2. And here, you have a minus a plus 2, 2 divided by 2, 1. Q equal 1 is a fixed point. And you can see it easily here. But if you apply this transformation twice, you get back to the starting point.
So by imposing a family of dualities.
If I take a equals 0, this becomes 1 divided by q. If I take a equal 2, this becomes 2 minus q. So the two transformations that we used successfully with Gell-Mann to explain the data of NASA here are particular cases. So the idea is, by using this generalized transformation, can we do other systems more complex than the solar wind? And we did this a few months ago with a mathematical physicist from Paris, Jean-Pierre Gazot, and myself, and we showed that all these things is related to the well-known Möbius transforms in mathematics. And when you do all that, you arrive to this relation. And this relation is, of course, satisfied by the solar wind here, because it was constructed on the structure, on the logical structure of the solar wind. So it satisfies this too. But during 15 years, I was looking how to satisfy other q-triplets that are in the literature. For example, for the Feigenbaum point, the Brazos River, which is in Texas, Bitcoin in economics, the standard map, the ozone layer, the solar activity. There are plenty of q-triplets around in the literature, and we were trying to understand how they are connected.
So just so I understand you, so each of these q's corresponds to a particular algorithm I can apply to a time series of data.
You can say that. I like to think that a specific class of properties, but it is equivalent to an algorithm.
So I could apply this. I mean, I could compute these or approximate these on any given set of data.
Yes, you could, on a time series.
And I see.
This is what the NASA did.
I see. And so you're conjecturing here the existence of this kind of
Möbius structure inside. So with this, we could also explain, within error bars, small error bars, the Feigenbaum point and the Brazos River. That was a big happiness, because I was looking to satisfy, in particular, the Feigenbaum point during more than 10 years without success. And by using this Möbius transform structure, we could do it. So the Feigenbaum point now is okay. And we took a bonus. The Brazos River in Texas also is okay. But this is not enough. This seems to be a good path, but it's not enough. Because other examples like the Bitcoin in economics, the ozone layer, the solar activity are out of this. So this needs to be further generalized somehow to get the whole set of data inside.
So sorry, what would it imply if all of those fixed points did line up at zero? What
yes.
What would the implications of this be?
That we have found how different cues for a given system are connected among them.
But the fact that they were all connected according to a single law would tell you, that would be a very profound statement about the nature of...
It would.
Something, I don't know about what. I mean,
yeah, it would. In fact, what we believe is that in the infinite number of cues that you can define for a given system, there are only two, maybe three, independent. All the others are simple functions of those two or three.
As a mathematical statement.
Yes. And we're trying to find what would be the connections between all cues on the two or three that might be independent. And those two or three depend on the strong correlations inside the system. Either it's inanimate matter or living matter.
These are somehow like the critical exponents.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, very similar. In fact, myself, I worked during, I don't know, 20 years in critical phenomena. And of course, I was inspired by this to propose all these things. So, I would like to end just by, I could end here, but if you have 5 minutes of patience, I can show to you some very recent physical example, economics, etc. So a physical long-range example that was published a few months ago by these four people from Milan, Italy. And they write there, that thus the Gibbs prescriptions are not dynamically justified, because to justify it, the normal Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics, you need strong chaos. And when you have long-range interactions, you don't have strong chaos. You have weak chaos, and changes everything. And they also say, so Gibbs doesn't work. Finally, a preliminary indication was given that non-classical Q's distributions may be significant and presumably for the whole domain of atomic physics. So Gibbs does not work, and they verify in their example that Q statistics works. So I will not enter into details, but all these pictures are consistent with their statements. And many other things like the Mendeleev table, it follows a Q exponential. And the famous Debye-Hückel law in chemical engineering, as well as the Yukawa exponential decay in nuclear physics, they are correct only in the beginning. Log linear, you have a straight line. Then you have, in fact, a Q exponential. You don't have an exponential, which is this, you have a Q exponential. In this example for the capacitors, they got Q equal 1.33. This is used all the time in chemical engineering, and this is one of the most popular models in nuclear physics with Yukawa potential. They are very good approximations, but they are not strictly correct. And finally, there are also data in economics, many, many data in economics, fitting all that I said. But I will skip this, and I thank you your patience.
So, Artem, do you have a question?
Maybe. I was wondering if there's a simplistic, maybe, way to just give an idea of how one would measure these different Q relaxation, Q stationary, from a time series.
Yes.
I mean, presumably we get a time series from...
Yes. I can give you a couple of illustrations. You have a time series, right?
Yes.
As a function of time.
Yes.
So it goes up and down.
Presumably, it could even be from the stationary regime.
Suppose you have all that kind of things. So if you have this as a function of time, you project this data here, and you will have something around zero, because it goes up and down. So you have a distribution. That distribution might be a Q Gaussian. And from this projection here, you get Q. Q stationary state. Exactly. But now you can do something else. You have this data, and you can take a window here and see the correlation between this point and this point, and then average through here, 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 here. Exactly. And this will give you relaxation. Yes, yes. And then the third one was sensitivity, which is related to entropy. And you can analyze this, and you can get the f of alpha multifractal function from the data. The f of alpha is like this. The two standing points of f of alpha with these two numbers, it's an important way for characterizing multifractals, which are more general than fractals. If you have a dust, a big dust, and you want to analyze it, you might very easily go back to a f of alpha specific function for that dust. When you have this f of alpha function, you have the value here and here that are called alpha minimum and alpha maximum. With those two, we have an analytical relation that gives you Q sensitivity. Like what? No. It uses very heavily scale invariance. Scale invariance. F of alpha is a big way of characterizing multifractals, where you have all types of scale invariances in the system.
And the inspiration is kind of similar to like fluctuation dissipation or something like that.
Well, in this stuff, you generalize the fluctuation dissipation. You obtain a Q generalization of fluctuation dissipation because the stationary states here, it's typical for a living organism, it does not only depend on the difference of two times, it also depends on both times and not the difference. So if I run 100 meters, I get without breath, and it takes a few minutes to go back to normal. When I was 20 years old, I ran the same 100 meters, and it took a few seconds to go back to normal. Let's ask my son. So it depends not only on the difference of times, but also on the initial time. When
it's not autonomous.
Because
it's not autonomous system.
It violates causality at the end of the story. It has to do with causality. So when you have such systems, fluctuation dissipation theorem has to be generalized. And in some cases, it has been generalized. Like 20 years ago, there was a paper.
Is there like a good reference where I could, sort of like a textbook type reference where I could see more, in maybe extensively, no pun intended, or non-extensive, the way your work connects with like classical thermodynamics, especially with critical scaling phenomena and so on?
The connection with thermodynamics, which was the question that he put, you can find it explained with some detail in a paper by myself and Sirto in 2013. So there is only one paper, Tsallis Sirto, 2013, and there we start by heavily discussing the Legendre transform of this business. You can start there. There, the purpose was to apply this kind of idea to black holes. But there is a nice introduction with thermodynamics.
Michael?
In the standard model that you showed, if you do the average over just one orbit, do you get also Q Gaussian, or is it when you average over many orbits together that you get
many together? Many together.
So each orbit is Gaussian, but then when you average over many.
Well, it's not even Gaussian because each orbit gives you something which is restricted in X. It's not something like a square like this. It's not even Gaussian. But when you do the average over all phase space, this is what they did, you get Q Gaussians or Gaussians depending on the value of K, or a mixture of Gaussians and Q Gaussians.
So you mentioned this transformation and duality.
Maybe.
You know the duality in information geometry, which goes from alpha to minus alpha, basically. So do you have...
Maybe it's related, because in a couple of papers 10 years ago, Amari and collaborators established...
It is related with the additive one, but not with the multiplicative one.
Yeah.
So did you have any... discussions with people from...
No.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your attention.
I'm glad you pointed out that it was Wednesday.
You thought it was on the...